Hi everybody, today is February 1st, 2013. Well, we got the Fast and the Furious screw up. What are they going to call this in Milwaukee? Thanks to one of my subscribers, they sent me this information. ATF's Milwaukee sting operation marred by mistakes and failures. David Slank unknowingly rented his building to ATF, which ran an undercover sting. Burglars broke into the business, ending the operation. Slank says the ATF owes him $15,000 for damages and unpaid utility bills. The agency has refused to pay. Refused to pay for damages on their utility bill? Unbelievable. But it gets worse. A store calling itself Fearless Distributing opened early last year on an out-of-the-way street in Milwaukee's River West neighborhood, offering designer clothes, athletic shoes, jewelry, and drug paraphernalia. Those working behind the counter, however, weren't interested in selling anything. They were undercover agents from the U.S. Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, running a storefront sting aimed at busting criminal operations in the city by purchasing drugs and guns from felons. But the effort to date has not snared any major dealers or taken down a gang. Instead, it resulted in a string of mistakes and failures, including an ATF military-style machine gun landing on the streets of Milwaukee, and the agency having $35,000 in merchandise stolen from its store, a Journal Sentinel investigation has found. Yep, let's put more guns on the street, and this time we'll just get them from the government. When the 10-month operation was shut down after the burglary, agents and Milwaukee police officers who participated in the sting cleared out the store, left behind a sensitive document that listed names, vehicles, and phone numbers of undercover agents. And the agency remained locked in a battle with the building's owner, who he says is owed about $15,000 because of utility bills, holes in the walls, broken doors, and damage from an overflow toilet. The sting resulted in charges being filed against about 30 people, most for low-level drug sales and gun possession counts. But agents had the wrong person in at least three cases. In one, they charged a man who was in prison as a result of an earlier ATF case. At the time, agents said he was selling drugs to them. Sounds like they're making up false accusation, false lies, trumped up police charges. I don't think they had the wrong name. They just decided to go after somebody and didn't know he was already in jail. The other case revealed that the agency's operation was paying such high prices that some defendants bought guns from stores such as Gardner Mountain and then sold them to the agents for a quick profit. The mistakes by the agents are troubling and suggest that a lack of planning and oversight, according to veterans of the ATF, who learned about the operation from the Journal Sentinel. The newspaper combed through police records, court documents, social media, and materials left behind by the ATF, all of which provide a rare view inside the undercover federal operations. I have never heard of those kinds of problems in an operation, said Michael Bouchard, who retired 5 years ago as assistant director for field operations for the agency. Sure, small bits and pieces, but that many in one case? I've never heard of anything like that. The agency has been on the defense in recent years following the ill-fated Fast and Furious operation run out of Arizona, where agents allowed sales of more than 2,000 guns to gun traffickers, but they failed to keep track of most of them. Many turned up in crime scenes in Mexico, including two at the site where the U.S. border guard was killed. And now, in the wake of school shootings in Connecticut, as President Barack Obama considers new restrictions on guns, the agency is poised to take on additional responsibilities. The ATF has run storefront stings in other cities, holding news conferences, trumpeting results, and showing off the guns and drugs seized. In Milwaukee, the operation has been kept quiet. Residents of the area, tucked between North Humboldt Boulevard and the Milwaukee River, are angry the ATF secretly drew drug dealers and gun-toting felons to their neighborhood, which is rallying to improve. Federal authorities said they could not say much about the Milwaukee operation because court cases have not been resolved and the ATF is still seeking suspects. U.S. Attorney James Santel, whose office was briefed on plans for the sting, declined to comment on problems in the operation, focusing instead on the number of defendants charged in the 145 guns seized, including 3 sawed-off shotguns, 10 stolen guns, and 8 guns with obliterated serial numbers. Santel said that all federal investigations are not the same, and noted in this case, four of the defendants are facing long prison terms for being career armed criminals. They are plainly a threat to the community, said. But yet they got a machine gun somewhere out on the streets. ATF spokesman Special Agent Robert Smith said he is convinced the operation didn't bring crime to the neighborhood and instead made the streets of Milwaukee safer. Smith declined to say how much the sting operation cost. Our number one responsibility is denying criminal access to firearms, and that's what we're trying to do, Smith said. It is our duty to purchase these firearms to protect the American public and citizens of Milwaukee. When David Salkin put his single-story building on East Meineke Avenue up for rent on Craigslist, he had a choice, lease to a church or Fearless Distribution. He went with the upstate Fearless operation because they were willing to take all 8,000 square feet of the building and pay the $3,200 in monthly rent in cash. The agent who signed the lease gave Salkin a fake name and home address. Fearless was not registered with the state. The agents told Salkin their operation was new, and they would get to that. The agents, wearing t-shirts that said Brew City Hustle, carved out a part of the warehouse for a showroom of jeans, coats, shoes, and purses, along with bongs and fake urine for those trying to beat a drug test. They also set up an office with cash counting machines. They installed secret cameras and a command center where the sting would be run. The operation created a Facebook page and chose a striking logo. A skull with a slew of guns and knives fanned out behind, ripped off from a recent Sylvester Stallone movie, The Expendables. The store didn't say it was in the gun business, but the logo suggested that. Agents let it be known that they were willing to buy guns and drugs according to documents from the circuit court charges. The records didn't say how they did that, but agents had business cards with the Fearless logo and the words buy, sell, or trade. The cards were found by the landlord after agents left. Salkin, who previously ran his sign business from the building, was a first-time landlord. He said he saw little of the Fearless operation because they mostly kept him out. What he saw gave him suspicion. It looked to him like they were selling counterfeit goods, but the rent was coming in, a relief after months without a tenant. As secretive as the ATF was with Salkin, there were hints of what was going on. Workers at the tannery across the street noticed people going into the store carrying packages and guns, then coming out empty-handed. Odd for a place that was supposed to be selling things, they thought. Mike Zelensky, a UPS driver in the area, said he asked people running the operation if they needed to get an account for deliveries. What they said puzzled him. They said they wouldn't be sending or getting anything. And I thought that was odd because distributing is in their name. Fearless Distributing, he said. I was wondering, what kind of business is that? They never sent or received anything via UPS in 10 months, Zelensky said. Milwaukee is among 31 cities where the ATF has dedicated a violent crime impact team. The teams are supposed to target hotspots, small, high-crime areas, and go after the worst of the worst violent criminals, according to the agency's best practice report. In more than half the cases studied, the ATF used citywide data rather than numbers from the target areas, favorably skewing their analysis when reporting on homicides committed with firearms, the report found. And teams in several of the cities failed to implement key strategies, such as compiling worst-of-the-worst lists, engaging in community outreach, or utilizing tracking and other technology resources. Still, the initiative expanded in 2006 with the addition of Birmingham, Alabama, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, Milwaukee, and other cities. In Milwaukee, agents located Fearless Distributing in a neighborhood where aggravated assaults had been declining since at least 2008, according to an analysis by the Journal Sentinel, relying on Milwaukee Police Department numbers. Aggravated assaults within a mile radius of the storefront dropped to 109 last year from 193 in 2008. Homicides in the area ranged from 0 to 3 per year during the last 5 years, far fewer than other crime-laden areas in the city. ATF spokesman Smith would not say why the agency chose that location for a storefront sting. Probably close to one of the ATF officer's girlfriends. We pick a neighborhood if there is a property appropriate for what our needs are, Smith said. You look for pockets in the city, and you look for a number of other mechanisms that go into it in order to make a decision. Smith said he didn't know of any recent evaluation, local or regional, examining the effectiveness of their operation. Look at how many cases have gone to the U.S. attorney, he said. Nationally, the agency's website touts numbers showing teams referred an average of 671 cases per year for criminal charges from 2006 through 2009, with a 14-year average prison sentence for those convicted. The Department of Justice issued news releases in Baltimore, Atlanta, and elsewhere in the last couple of years praising the success of individual operations. It's probably all propaganda, bullcrap. In March, an undercover ATF sting made news in Richmond, California for other reasons. When a gun-buying deal went bad, an agent shot a suspect in the parking lot of a restaurant, sending customers diving for cover. ATF officials defended the operation and agents' actions. Smith said funding for violent crime impact teams is being reduced in the agency's $1.2 billion budget, and that ATF is launching a new improved initiative in coming months called Frontline. Top dollar paid for guns. Fearless Distributing was buying guns and drugs by March of last year. The sellers came from outside the River West neighborhood, mostly from the near north side of Milwaukee, according to court documents. The amount of drugs involved ranged from a gram of cocaine or an ounce of marijuana to an ounce of cocaine and 7 grams of heroin on the high end. One charge is for selling fake drugs. Gun charges also vary. The ATF generally targets gun sellers using statutes that prohibit felons from having guns. The number of guns seized range from a single firearm to 25 to 30 guns. ATF agents were paying top dollar for guns, court documents show. For instance, Vance Field sold a Smith & Wesson 40 caliber handgun to agents at Fearless in September for $1,250, according to the criminal complaint. The model was sold for roughly $400 to $700 in online actions recently. In one case, Brandon Gadney sold more than 30 guns to ATF agents, including some that he and Corvorzi Bryant bought at Garden Mountain, according to court documents. Bryant is charged in federal court with being a straw buyer, someone who purchased firearms for another person who is prohibited from having them. Daniel Stiller, head of the Federal Defense Service in Milwaukee, said such undercover operations are rare. The case involved Gadney and Bryant suggest to him that those defendants weren't major criminals, given they got guns from a store, not the street.